rejoice in your saving deeds. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null, and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends upon faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of all of us. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, so numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old. Or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb, no distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, it was
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who were ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable unto you, O Lord God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So as mentioned, it's good to be here. Noel and I have been friends for quite a number of years now, and for quite a while we've been doing sermon prep together every week. He may have mentioned that to you. It was easy when I was in Kingston to get to go to Starbucks and sit and go over the readings. Now that I'm further up north, we've been going over Zoom, and I have to make my own coffee, which is not quite as fun. But during that time when we've been talking, we often share not just about the readings, but how we're going to approach our different congregations, because all of our different congregations are different. And at one point, we started discussing the fact it would be kind of neat to meet the congregations that we've been talking about all the time. So it's good to be here with you this morning. Despite the lack of, the train stopping me from getting here, you are much more straightforward than my churches are for some of them, and I think Noel's got to go through some back roads to get to where he goes, so we'll find out if he made it or not. Gospel of Mark. This morning we're dealing with chapter 8 of Mark's Gospel, and I would have to say that over the last while I have been quite fascinated. fascinated by Mark's gospel, particularly its brevity and the drama that you get in Mark's gospel. N.T. Wright says that Mark's gospel is the gospel for a cynic in a hurry, and that it is meant really to be read behind locked doors by candlelight with a group of co-conspirators that are waiting at any moment for the authorities to break in through the door and to stop you. It has this sense of immediacy that goes through the gospel, which is normally not actually my style. My favorite gospel is Luke's gospel, the storyteller, the gospel writer who believes, you know, why use one word when you can use 10 words to describe something. It's almost the exact opposite of how Mark does things. And yet, as I said, I've been really enjoying this last year as we've been preaching through this year through Mark's gospel. Not just getting a lot out of his brevity and drama, but how he uses that to just get right down to business. Right? Mark is no fuss, no muss, and then he asks us and almost demands of us some questions every single time we read them. Questions that are often not all that easy to answer for ourselves. And this morning, he asks us a couple of questions about identity and about our expectations as well. Now, if we're going to really understand this little portion of Mark's gospel this morning that we're looking at, we have to first sort of reach back a little further into chapter 8 of Mark's gospel, get a little background, and I think we actually have to take a little look at Matthew's gospel as well, because he gives us some of the details that Mark tends to leave out here. But in essence, Jesus had brought his disciples to the community of Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi was a mostly Gentile community, fairly large trading center just on the edge of Israel. And it was known as a very Greek and Roman-influenced community. And it was particularly known for being a community that worshipped everybody. So they had temples all the way through the entire city that were to every Greek god, every Roman god, a whole bunch of pagan gods. It was just this center of all these different religions. And it's there where Jesus chose to bring his disciples to ask them two important questions. First one, who are people saying that I am? The second question, the more important question, he asked them, who do you say that I am? And remember how this goes, right? It's Peter who answers on behalf of the entire group. It's Peter who says out loud for the very first time what all the disciples have been thinking about, what all the disciples have been secretly talking amongst themselves about, what they've all been secretly hoping could actually be true. You are the Messiah. You are the one sent by God. It's actually a huge moment for the disciples, and a climactic point in Mark's gospel that is almost immediately ruined when Jesus begins to then talk about what it means to actually be the Messiah, saying that he will have to suffer many things and that he will die at the hands of the very people who are meant to welcome him the most, the religious authorities. And then again by Peter, who takes exception to what Jesus has been saying. He pulls Jesus aside and he reprimands him. And he says, you can't talk like that anymore. This can't possibly be the actual plan. I will never let this happen to you. And then Jesus reprimanding Peter back, calls him Satan, because he says, thinking about the way he wants it to be, thinking about the plan that Peter wants to see and not the plan that God has to see. It is an emotional roller coaster of a passage, right? Very few verses, and yet incredible highs, and then some incredible lows. And it really shows this increasing break between Jesus and his disciples, something that they're just not understanding about what Jesus is teaching. Something that they will in fact struggle with for the entire rest of their time with Jesus. Because Jesus has been pretty clear since he started his public ministry about what everything was going on. He arrives in Galilee and he says, God's promises are coming true. The kingdom of God is near. And he tells everyone that that because the kingdom of God is near, that they are to repent of their sins and to just believe this good news. And then he goes about not just teaching that message, but teaching through his actions as well, showing everyone through the different miracles that he does what that kingdom of God looks like, what that kingdom of God will feel like to live in. And so we've seen this here since Christmas, this whole series of miracles where Jesus has shown that the kingdom of God is a place of healing and wholeness, where the kingdom of God is a place where the people who are there can expect to see God's glorious presence right there with them all the time. That it is a kingdom that is open to everyone. Even the people, the disciples, are not so sure, should probably be there. Jesus is saying, no, the kingdom of God is open for everyone who trusts in the king, who comes to the king. And Jesus has lately been teaching over and over that the kingdom of God is a place where everyone serves everyone else, even the king, maybe even especially the king. And that's the part that the disciples are having so much trouble with, because they have some very different expectations about how this is all supposed to go. They have some very specific expectations about what's going to happen because they've been hanging out with the Messiah. And very few of them involve service. And a whole lot of them involve being served. They are not so much into giving up their own way and taking up their cross as Jesus is encouraging them. Because they want the kingdom of God, but they want it without the sacrifice. They want it without all the mess that Jesus is talking about. They're looking for the military Messiah, the one who's going to come and get rid of Rome for them. And then, oh boy, wouldn't it be great, right? We're right there by Jesus when he takes the crown, and we'll be able to move right into Caesar's great palace with him. No more fishing for a living for us. And then Jesus keeps telling them that the plan is something completely different. And they will struggle so much with this new identity he wants them to have, and struggle so much with the expectations they have. Just shortly after this passage, they'll be wandering again, and Jesus will be teaching as they walk along behind them, and he'll catch them fighting with each other over which one of them is the greatest, okay? Trying to decide how the pecking order in the kingdom of God is going to go. James and John will send their mom to go and speak to Jesus and say, wouldn't it be nice if you gave a special little place to my boys? They're just not catching this sense that Jesus says the kingdom operates in a way that takes everything we think the world works and just flips it completely upside down. And so because of that, they are willing to settle. They are willing to settle for just freedom from Rome and a comfortable life. Instead of what Jesus is saying, he has on offer for not just them, but for all of us. Freedom from the actual thing that keeps us oppressed, sin and death. And giving to us a life that is fulfilled now and everlasting. And yet that expectation for them is hard to give up. And we know that feeling too. The expectations that we often have are not all that different from the disciples. And so Mark asks us some pretty sharp questions in this reading this morning about our own expectations, about our own sense of identity and who we are. He asks some pretty difficult questions about who we really think Jesus is. Because if we think that Jesus is, if we believe that Jesus is who we say he is, then we have to believe that he is the one that was there from the beginning of creation. He is the one that created our lives, gave us life, created our souls, died for us, risen again to give us that life. And if that is the case, then he really does know what he's talking about in our life. And so when he says that if we do not enter this way of sacrificing for other people, take on that identity as one who serves, then we risk losing everything. Our life now and that life to come. And so how do we deal with those expectations for ourselves and for God? I'm fairly well known in my own family for saying numerous times that the secret to happiness is low expectations. If you go to an event and you really don't think it's going to be anything, even if it's mildly good, it was a good event, right? But if you go with huge expectations, expecting lots of great things to happen, it's really easy to get disappointed. I think I grew up starting to use it as a bit of a defense mechanism for my heart, right? Low expectations, you do not get disappointed. My wife, Cassie, on the other hand, is the exact opposite of that. She has the highest of expectations for everything that we go to and every person she meets and for herself. She's more disappointed than I am often. But she's living the life the way that God asks us to be as his disciples. That we are meant to have some very particular expectations. Not like the original disciples were, of great expectations of wonderful things happening to them and praise and glory going to them. But instead, we're supposed to have some huge expectations for God. For this God who promises us that he has such a love for us and such grace for us that he wants to give us abundant life now and eternal life to come, even though we have done nothing to deserve it. We're just supposed to believe in that expectation. We're going to have some pretty big expectations for a God who says he has a part for us, a meaningful role in our life, no matter what point our life is in, or how young, how old we are. He has a life of meaning for us in helping other people find that kingdom. A meaningful role for us in his plan to save the entire world. And that he has for us that everlasting life as our reward. And so if we're going to have that kind of high expectation of God, then we should have some pretty high expectations of ourselves as well. To be willing to sometimes put aside the plan that we have. The way that we would like things to go for myself, often the way I think it would be better if God would just do it this way. And it never is. But just as to be able to put aside some of those things and instead go, I want to follow where God wants me to go. I'm willing to put some risk into that. I'm willing to put some service into that. As Jesus says, I'm willing to take up my own cross and to follow him. And the expectation is that when we do that, when we take that risk with God, the reward starts now as he gives us that meaningful, fulfilling life and that time with him forever. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you have called us as your followers, as your disciples, to follow you not just in thought, but in mind and in heart, to be the ones that will take up our cross and to follow you in that way of sacrifice that you have shown us. And you know that that is often difficult for us to do. And so we ask that you would give us your spirit so that we may be those that you call us to be. That you will help us to have high expectations, not just of you, but of ourselves. So that we may partake in that plan that you have for bringing the whole world to you. In Jesus' name we pray.